In today's adventure, I make a strange noise.
Whoa, this is freaky!
I make another strange noise. And I eat a burger in America. But first, let's go to Seattle.
Awesome news. I just bought that car. Yes, it cost a crap load of money, and yes, I've just spent the last hour and a half calling 5 different insurance companies to get the damn thing insured, but it's insured. Now I'm going to start the journey from here in Seattle, Washington, all the way across the United States to Florida. Come and join me. It's going to be one hell of an adventure.
I've got to stop and fill up the thing with
Oh, it's my baby's first gas stop. And I'm gonna treat with some. No, I'm gonna go straight for the V-Power. No, $3.50! Oh my god! Gas is expensive here! I've been spoiled in Florida. Yikes. Okay, let's go with that one. So I've only had this car for 3 hours and already people are getting interested in it. You have to get yourself one, mate.
You know what, yes, because this car is only one car I can it.
And my new Ukrainian friend was able to translate some of the documents that came with the car.
Okay, so this was in the first aid kit. And you're from Ukraine, so what does it what does it say?
Okay, it's it said about the factory when it was produced.
Uh-huh.
And this is the serial number of this one.
This first aid
kit. This is the serial number. This is the price, and it was made in Odessa, Ukrainian.
Wow. Funny thing is, that really cool dude just chased me down the road a little bit to tell me that your light's out. So that's something I've got to fix already. Funny, I expected better from Soviet light bulbs.
But before I could start my journey, I needed some tools in case it broke down.
So, I'm in Walmart. I'm gonna get some light bulbs, screwdrivers, tools, duct tape, string, water, all the stuff I could possibly need for a 3,500-mile journey in the Soviet off-roader. Gotta say, after just 20 kilometers, my butt hurts. Oh, this is gonna be a long journey. Right, some rope will be handy. Metric spanners. What else? Sockets. Metric sockets. That could be very useful. And I've got everything. I just wanted to get some paper towels, but I forgot the state goes into lockdown at midnight tonight. So I think I should just get out of the state. Washington, sorry I never get a chance to explore you, but you're kind of wet. Now, I don't want to be dramatic, but I'm sure I can smell the gas from here. My god, it's just like my old Lada. As soon as you fill it up, it just reeks of gasoline.
In order to fix the car's tail light, I needed to figure out what kind of bulb it took. But as I was taking things apart, I noticed the car had attracted even more onlookers.
I've got more people admiring the Lada. And where are you guys from?
Russia.
You're from Russia? Okay, there you go. Welcome home. Look at that. One quick trip to AutoZone later. Alright, we are ready to escape Washington State.
I wanted to cover at least a little bit of distance on that first night, so just 3 hours away, my destination was Portland in Oregon.
Well, I'm a tired little Kiwi. I'm at a Motel 6 in Portland. It's not cheap, but it is awful.
You thought I was kidding.
I got woken up at 6 o'clock this morning by some crazy person. Oh yeah, it's been one of those nights. Some crazy person banging on the door. Got the wrong room. Okay, Portland's interesting.
Off we go to see Nikki Gordon Bloomfield from Transport Evolved. First, I've got to get out of Portland, Oregon. First, I've got to start this thing. Doesn't start much easier than that.
I put my trust in Google to get me out of Portland City, which went well.
God, I just started here. This thing just made me do a complete bloody loop. Google, you suck.
Eventually, I made it out of Portland City and had to stop and get some gas, but I realized that in Oregon, you're not actually allowed, for whatever reason, to pump your own gas.
Hey, how you going?
The car was all tanked up, and I had my face mask on, which meant it was time to meet an old friend, Nikki Gordon Bloomfield from Transport Evolved, who was busy working on a project of her own.
The Soviet mustard machine has arrived me intact to the hub of Transport Evolved, and this is a project, this is Nikki, as everyone knows. This is a Honda Insight. Now this started life as a hybrid, right?
Right. Check the back out.
Here we go. Okay.
Watch the wheel.
It's got like Citroen air suspension.
Non-standard.
Adjustable suspension wasn't the weirdest thing about this Honda Insight, which started life as a hybrid, then became electric, and is now going to become electric again. Wait till you see what's under the hood.
See how many seconds it takes you to realize what's under the hood.
Okay, let's have a look.
Under the bonnet, there you go.
Okay, Zilla controller, I recognize the Zilla controller.
Right, that's going to go, because it's a prototype Zilla.
Okay, I don't recognize this motor, but it's AC.
Yep, look at the nameplate.
It's not out of an EV1, is it? How did you get a motor out of an EV1? How did you? That's forbidden fruit.
Forbidden.
Oh my God.
It's out of an EV1.
Are you allowed to say how you got it?
Well, it came with the car. So,
oh, right, okay. How did the original owner get it, I wonder?
I think when they were converting it, there were still parts available for the EV1.
Wow. Nikki's goal is to convert this thing back to electric, having it run on the EV1 motor with a generous-sized battery pack in it, which would make it an ultra-efficient electric car. While I was there, she showed me her other electric cars in the fleet and interviewed me for Transport Evolved, which you can watch by clicking on the link underneath this video in the description. In the video, we talked about the car's pros and cons, what I plan to do with it when I convert it to electricity, and she also gave me some great advice on a real fish and chip shop back in Portland, Oregon. So I had to go back into the city.
Just about to leave Portland, Oregon, but I can't go without getting fish and chips. Nikki recommended a really good fish and chip place run by an actual Scotsman, somewhere around here. The Frying Scotsman.
Got my fish and chips. Oh, check this out. I haven't had fish and chips this unhealthy in about a year and a half since I was back in New Zealand. Oh, this is going to be awesome. All right, goodbye Portland. Thanks for all the fish and chips. Just please make it stop raining. All right, and we're off.
The first main leg of the journey had started. I was leaving Portland, Oregon, with my destination being Sacramento in California. It was going to be a long, long journey in a car with a top speed of about 55 miles an hour. So, with the heater on and my jacket wrapped around me, I got busy eating my fish and chips, heading south towards the California sunshine. And the car was running fine, at least at this stage, despite a minor leak or two. And with thousands of miles in front of me, I was in a good mood. I mean, what could go wrong?
All right, so I am on Highway 5, heading south. My goal today is Sacramento, but that is still 7.5 hours away, so who knows if I'm gonna make it. My biggest problem is this.
The mountains are coming. Lots and lots of mountains. And this is not a very powerful car.
The car was still relatively unknown to me, so I was watching the temperature gauge like a hawk and learning just how quickly it drank through petrol. This meant that I had to stop every 200 miles or so to fill up, but that's okay because I had plenty of time. I also got to put the car through its paces to see just how truly powerful it is by actually overtaking another vehicle.
I'm gonna overtake something. Check this out. I'm overtaking something! Woohoo! Oh yeah, baby! Yes! I overtook something! Yes, it was a truck going up a hill, but I overtook something! Woohoo!
The truck soon overtook me when we got back onto the straights, but that's okay, because I had to once again stop and fill up, and then stop and fill up once again, and before long I was getting near the California border. Which meant having to go through an agricultural inspection, which was basically just the officials asking me if I had any fruit in the car.
Hi. No fruit, no. Thanks all. That was easy.
From then on, it was a few more hours to Sacramento, which meant that by the time I arrived, I was one tired little Kiwi.
Alright, after last night's Fleabag cockroach motel, because I travel a lot for work, I've accrued a fair amount of points, which I've never actually used, but I've got enough points for a night in an actual hotel tonight. Oh man, I've earned this. Okay, so that is some loud carpeting, but already I can see this is just 10,000% better than that Portland Petri dish I was in yesterday. Oh man, it's loud, but I love it because it's 100% free. All right, I'm going to bed. Good night. Good morning. Another day on the road, but I have something to make today a little bit cooler. Check out the shirt that the seller gave me. With a new shirt on my back, I was ready to jump into that California sunshine.
Are you serious? It's raining again? Here's hoping the further south I go, the better the weather will get. So today's mission, San Diego.
First of all, I needed to get south of Sacramento, so I jumped on the highway. And as I was fleeing the rain, something pretty amazing happened in front of me.
Something magical is right in front of me, and it has blown my mind. Take a look. Look at that.
Hang on, let me wipe the water from the windscreen.
Look at that. Blue sky. See, now everyone told me that, oh, California, wildfires, such a dry state. But that's not the impression I got when I got here. But finally, I might get some sunshine. It's been two bloody days of rain and I'm sick of it.
I got my wish, because for the first time in more than 2 days of rain and wind and cold weather, the California sunshine made an appearance and started to warm me up. And pretty soon, it was time to enjoy a breakfast on the road.
Alrighty, time for a delicious hotel breakfast, which is basically a brown bag with some crap in it, because this is the era of COVID-19. What do we got? 600 calories of sugar, healthy. What else we got? A banana, oh my god, it's the first fruit I've had in 2 days. And a muesli bar. And wait for dessert, water. I gotta tell you though, further south I get into California, the hotter I'm getting, and I've gotta try and take this bloody thing off without crashing. Somehow. Ugh. Starting to roast.
So I channeled my inner Mr. Bean and managed to somehow take off my winter coat without killing myself and all those around me.
So I was cruising on the highway about 20 minutes ago. I didn't have the cameras rolling, but there was a car behind me, a gray Charger, just a boring looking car, and it was tailgating me. And I was wondering, why is this car so close? And then I realized that they had light strips hidden on the top of the window. It was an undercover police car. And I'm thinking, oh God, this is the last thing I need. I'm a resident alien driving a weird car with no license plate. Please don't pull me over. And he was following me for about 15 seconds, getting really close to read the document on the back. And I was like, oh, waiting for the lights to turn on. And then finally he just shot past. I thought, oh, thank God. But anyway, a friend recommended that I see something. I hope you can hear me over the sound of this Soviet drivetrain. But I'm in California, and a friend of mine suggested I take this off-ramp coming up right in front of me, because there's something pretty interesting here. It's very electric car related. Oh, my ears. What a racket. So apparently there is something really interesting here. There it is. Okay, check this out.
My car is going to stick out like a gas-burning thumb doing this.
Check this out. The world's largest Tesla supercharger. What a monster. Solar panels on the roof, Tesla's charging, and me killing the planet driving through it. Please don't hate me, people. Look at all the superchargers. And there's room for growth as well. That's insane. Wow.
I have made a pit stop at the world's largest Tesla supercharger station. This Tesla supercharger in Fireball, California had no fewer than 56 rapid charging units for Tesla cars. This was great inspiration for my old Lada, which would one day be running on electrons.
Well, that was fun. They're getting their electrons and I have to go and get my fuel. Unfortunately, it's a dirty, filthy kind that's killing us all, but... Oh, come on, baby, don't die on me now. Let's go. What flavor gas? Chevron 76 or Valero? I'm feeling exotic. Let's go with some Valero gas. Mamma mia.
After showing off my beautiful linguistic ignorance, I gave my car a liquid recharge and then planned my own recharge in liquid form.
Good morning, welcome to Starbucks. How can we get started for you?
Good morning. Could I please grab a small latte, but with a total of 3 shots of coffee?
Okay.
That's all.
You got it. I'll see you at the window. Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, mate. You guys haven't got a cup holder or anything, have you?
Cup holder?
Yeah.
Well, like... I got like a tray.
Oh, that'd be great.
Okay.
Awesome. Thanks, mate. Cheers.
We're halfway between Sacramento and San Diego. And so now the journey continues back on that noisy highway. This is the quietest it's been all day. Onwards. If only I'd known that that was going to be my last sip, I would have savored it more, because just a few miles down the road, a disaster took place in the passenger seat.
Bloody hell! I just bought the damn thing! These shitty California roads have killed my coffee!
Yep, the coffee had spilled all over my bag sitting on the back floor, so I pulled over to inspect the damage.
In 400 feet, turn right onto West Jane Avenue.
Shut your whore mouth. My underwear is soaked in coffee. Oh, bloody hell. Have you met me? I am a walking disaster. Why am I doing this? Why am I doing this journey? This is gonna go horribly wrong. I can't even drink coffee properly. G'day, Mike. So it turns out I'm going to need to use your washing machine when I arrive, because I managed to empty an entire cup of coffee over all my clothes in my bag. Oh, f*** a doodle do. Alright, let's get out of here.
But despite the coffee disaster, I was still in a great mood because I was finally doing something I'd wanted to do since I was a kid. A real road trip across the entire United States.
I'm doing it. I just realized I'm doing it. I'm doing a road trip across the United States. I wanted to do this since I was a kid.
and I'm eating a burger in America. This is fantastic. You've got to do this. I love it.
In fact, I was in such a good mood that rather than narrate the rest of this segment, let's just let the music play. But all good things must come to an end, and as I approached Los Angeles to get to San Diego, the infamous LA traffic soon soured my mood.
Great. 38-year-old Soviet car in traffic.
After a day of carefree, open highway cruising, being squashed into stop-start Los Angeles traffic had made me a bit agitated.
Bloody hell. Why would anyone live here?
Before long, I was turning into a bit of an angry little Kiwi.
You know, I think there's a reason why nature keeps trying to destroy this city.
It took another hour before I was able to get around Los Angeles and head south onto the more open highways. But with the sun setting, I finally escaped and made the short jump between Los Angeles and San Diego because I knew when I got to San Diego, something awesome was waiting for me.
I've been waiting for that for about 10 hours. That is good.
Friends Mike and Mark made me feel right at home, and the next day we went exploring San Diego, which I'll set to music. But more interesting than that was I got to explore a piece of 21st century technology, a Tesla Model 3.
Okay, so while Mike is taking a little blast of the Soviet Union for a drive, I am going to be testing the 21st century. Oh, I've only ever driven one of these once and I'm so excited, I can't wait to get behind the wheel. Oh, look at that.
So now just tap the gas and we're off.
Yep.
Oh, it's so quiet.
Yeah.
I've just done 3 days of this is so quiet.
Yeah.
God, I love this. Every time I drive a Tesla, which is, you know, admittedly only what, this is the third time in my life, I want to buy one. Oh. This is the future. It's a cliche now. Oh, this is the future, but this is the future. It just feels right.
Meanwhile, Mike was battling with Soviet technology.
We're seeing the Tesla.
I've thrown Mike back 30 years. Poor guy. I can hear my car over this.
Then it was Mark's turn to join Mike in the Soviet mustard machine, which was still reeking of gas.
Hi.
Hello.
Say hi to the two cameras.
Hello. It smells like a go-kart.
Yeah.
A little louder.
Mark's choking on the gasoline fumes. We're too accustomed to Teslas.
It smells like we're racing in a go-kart.
As for racing in a go-kart, we pulled the cars over and swapped drivers again. And then with Mike in the lead, we headed off down the road where I was waiting for a red light to prove the pure performance of the Soviet off-roader, taking on the mighty American electric vehicle in the ultimate drag race.
Ready?
Okay, that failed. But I wasn't going to give up. I caught up fast, and at the next red light I was going to really show them how four cylinders of pure Soviet muscle can take on the American giant. It was an effortless victory for the pure power Soviet off-roader.
Modern technology is no match for Soviet power! Ha ha!
But as we got back to the apartment, I wondered if he hadn't let me win.
I got a horrible feeling he let me win.
We swapped driving positions once again because I wanted to experience something unique to Tesla vehicles called autopilot, where on the highway, the car drives itself, and unfortunately, it resulted in some pretty embarrassing noises from me.
Yep. You got the blues on, then you're good.
Oh my god!
And then you can do this.
It's like, holy shit, it's turning myself! Holy shit! Whoa, this is freaky! This is not natural! Oh my god! My heart is pounding right now, eh? There's a car up ahead.
So now you have to give just a little bit of pressure and a little bit of love to the wheel.
Oh yeah, okay.
If you do it too much, it'll kick it out of autopilot, if you just do it a little bit.
Oh, it's slowing down. Oh mate, this is freaky as hell. Honestly, there's no way I could describe with words the sensation. You have to experience this for yourself, eh? You can't describe it, the video won't do it justice. In the straight, I can relax a little bit.
Yeah.
In the corners, it's like, yeah. Oh my god, this is so amazing. Honestly, I'm not just fabricating all of these wow sounds, this is just phenomenal. Oh, look at this, this guy's on human pilot. Look at him, he's all over the place. That's slowing down. Good car. That was just surreal. Like, you're used to this, right?
Yeah, but it makes the drive a lot easier.
Mate, that is...
Once you trust it.
Yeah. You saw me. That was. I was freaking out. But,
yeah.
But, oh, man.
Well, now we've seen your old face.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. So, yeah. You can, you're a fly on the bedroom wall. That's pretty much what it sounds like. Oh my god, it's doing it by itself! It's basically all the noise.
How do I turn it off?
Yeah, pretty much. Oh, look at that. This is the second time I've done it in my life, and I'm already much calmer. Man, human pilot sucks. Why aren't you all doing this? Human pilot, even though it's an i3, you're a human pilot. Loser.
After an amazing day of car-related experiences, we went out for a few drinks and had a lot of laughs, and I can't thank Mike and Mark enough for looking after me. But soon enough, the day was over, because tomorrow I had to continue my journey east. As I hit the highway and left San Diego, I was optimistic, but I wasn't even halfway yet in my journey, and I had to make a pit stop first. Okay, so I've got to make a little pit stop. I'm stopping here at a Walmart in order to get a gas can, and I'll tell you why in a second. Well, I found them. Now, what size did I get? 2 gallons, 5 gallons. Definitely 5 gallons. While I'm here, I also want to get some shorts, because I'm wearing long pants right now, and while that's fine for Seattle, I'm now on the southern border of the USA and it's starting to get hot in that car.
Alright, now, problem is, this car uses a lot of fuel. It has just a 1.6 litre non-fuel injected engine, so it's, not very high tech. The car weighs about 1.3 tonnes. It is the shape of a toaster oven, so it's got a lot of wind resistance. It's permanent four-wheel drive, you can't turn the four-wheel drive on or off, and it seems to have a tiny V-shaped gas tank. Now, all this combined means that doing 60 miles an hour, it uses around about, I would say, 10 gallons, and out of that, I really only get about 320 kilometers, around about just over 200 miles per charge, per fill up, which is quite low. It means that I'm stopping a lot, and when I'm going to be going across Nevada and Texas, there are going to be sections there without gas stations, and while I should be okay, it wouldn't hurt to be prepared in case I make a screw up and I forget. I look down, oh my god, I'm almost out of gas. So I've got a brand new gas tank. I'm going to go to the gas station now and fill up, and hopefully that'll see me through all the way home to St. Augustine in Florida, with a few more stops along the way. So now we get into the really nitty-gritty part. This is the long, painful part. Wish me luck.
I don't know which one of you didn't wish me luck, because at that moment, my luck ran out.
Now, I don't want to alarm anyone, but my oil pressure is getting a bit low, which is perhaps a cause for concern. I'm going to go and fill up and just check the oil level. That's kind of strange. And what's also interesting is if I idle, the engine cuts out. So I'm kind of concerned. Yeah. I'm going to take the next off-ramp and see if I can find a gas station.
But Google said the closest gas station was miles away, and things were getting worse.
Okay, I don't know what that light means, but that's not good. Oil pressure's low. This resisting light, whatever that means, that's turned on. Ah, shit. There's an off-ramp coming up, but it says no services. There's no gas station or anything. This is bad. I gotta keep going to the next gas station. Temperature's okay, the engine's not overheating, but it could be running out of oil. In which case, that's catastrophic. Oh shit. 14 miles to the next gas station. Holy fuck. Okay, now I'm worried. Oh man, I'm actually really worried. The light's gone out, but the problem hasn't gone away. Cars don't fix themselves. Don't die on me, come on.
Many minutes later, I'd found an off-ramp, and Google took me to a gas station just a few miles away. As I pulled into the gas station, tired, nervous, and worried about whether or not I'll make the journey, I went to check the oil, but at that moment, a group of people, as happens, pulled up alongside, curious about the car, so I had to try and act as calm as possible, while inside I was stressing my guts out.
Figure out what's going on. There you go. Yeah, it's throwing a bit of a tantrum right now, so...
Cool, what is it?
Lada, it's Russian.
Lada?
Yeah, I just bought it in Seattle, now I'm driving back home to Florida. So, what could go wrong? I've already got some problems.
You got this.
Yeah, I'm from New Zealand, I used to have one like back in the 90s. And I'm just going to figure out why. It's low oil pressure, I'm just hoping it's low on oil. It's probably not a level surface, so it might not give me a good
rating. Good luck.
I reckon I deserve an Emmy Award for acting that cool and that calm under pressure, while inside I was actually stressing out and panicking about whether or not the car's going to get me home. The oil level seemed fine. I couldn't see any obvious problem with it. So all I could do was go and fill the car up and try to plan my next move. But that's when I noticed something even worse taking place underneath it. That's gas leaking out. That is not good. That explains why I can smell gas all the time when I fill it up, because it's overflowing and pissing out. Oh, I've got extra 5 gallons of gas, the engine keeps cutting out, low oil pressure, even though there's oil in it. Oh man, I'm bloody nervous. I've only done a third of the journey. This is bad. I wasn't sure what to do at this stage, whether or not just to drive back to San Diego and put the car on a truck, or carry on, which would be foolish. So I did the foolish thing, and that's when I noticed my car began to fix itself.
Okay, here's something interesting. Remember a couple of hours ago, I said cars don't fix themselves? Well, look at this. The bloody oil pressure has improved. It's fixing itself. That's not supposed to happen.
The car was in a good mood again, which meant I was able to relax and get in a good mood myself. This allowed me to enjoy some of the amazing scenery in the United States.
Even if this car dies right now, I've still had one hell of an adventure. I mean, the difference in geography from the mountains of Seattle in the rain, down here to the middle of Arizona, the desert, I'm below sea level right now. It blows my mind. What a country. What a country.
With the Arizona sun setting behind me and Tucson in the distance, it was time for me to call it a night and get a good night's sleep, because tomorrow I enter Texas.
Another day, another leg of the journey. Just topped off the water, checked the oil. Looks okay. Come on, baby.
See, now that's a problem. That light down there is just to... Oh, and it's just turned off. What the hell? That's the alternator light I figured out. Looked on the internet. Turning on and off.
Oh, God.
Well, I don't know what I can do. Keep going and hope for the best.
My only fear is it breaking down in the middle of nowhere in the desert. See, if it breaks down in a city, I can get it fixed, or I can put it on a truck and get it shipped home. If it breaks down in the middle of the desert, I am f***ed.
Being about halfway through the journey now, I couldn't really turn back, so I decided to press on and tried to enjoy the trip as best I could while the car was behaving itself.
This was not on the plan. But I saw a billboard there that said, you know, like, real homemade jerky. And I've never really, I mean, I've had some packaged jerky before, but I'm going to go give it a shot. And they also sell pecan nuts and pistachios, locally grown. Somewhere, I don't see any field. Let's give it a go.
I'll get myself a little unhealthy snack. It's a thing about road trips, you know? You don't worry about eating healthy on a road trip. I eat healthy at work and all that. But when you're on a road trip, treat yourself. Eat all kinds of junk food. Treat my body like the crumbling Mayan temple that it is. Yum. All right, let's carry on. Behave.
As I made the milestone of New Mexico and filled up the car, the fumes were starting to get unbearable.
The fumes in here, the smell of petrol. Bloody hell. Yesterday I was bad, today it's even worse. It's making me sneeze and my head's clogging up. Oh.
And things went from bad to worse once I entered the state of Texas.
I don't know why, but the alternator light has come back on. And twice in the last half hour, the car has lost power for a third of a second.
So as I entered El Paso, I pulled off the highway to see if I could figure out the problem. Foot off the gas. The car has been losing power occasionally in little bursts. Then the alternator light came back on, so I got off the motor and I pulled in here on the side street. The alternator's now started working again, so I don't know what's going on. Do I press on or not? I just don't know. If the alternator dies and the power cuts out, I'm screwed. Whereas here, I mean, I could always get a tow truck and just put it on a shipping truck and just get it sent home, but I don't know. I've still got 1,000 miles, 1,500 miles to get home. Let's keep going. With the car being cantankerous, I wasn't sure if it was bravery or stupidity that made me press on at this point, but I did, and it wasn't long before I'd seen my first border patrol in the state of Texas. I did my best to act cool and calm while driving a car that was decidedly grumpy.
And I don't. Good, battling with an angry car.
Do you know the people in the Silverado that were in front of you?
No.
They told me your car was a Russian car.
So it is, yeah.
It really is?
Yeah, from the Soviet Union.
Oh man, how much was it?
$11,000. I actually bought it in Seattle about 5 days ago and driving it home to Florida.
Oh, well, have a nice job.
I hope it behaves. Come on.
I'd survived the inspection without cavity searches, which meant it wasn't long before I'd reached my hotel in Van Horn, where I was to treat myself with a well-earned beer.
Oh man, I have been waiting for this for a long time. Oh crap, hang on. These aren't twist off. Oh no. Oh no. Oh, a Bible. What the hell am I gonna do with that? I need a bloody bottle opener. There's gotta be a verse in here to magically open bottles, surely. Beer chapter 5, verse 7. For he was so desperate, he made a can opener out of his undies. Fortunately, my Lada keys came to the rescue, removing the cap and a bit of skin.
Yeah. What a mess. Can't take me anywhere. I'm bleeding. Worth it. Definitely worth it. Oh, that's good. Oh, I love beer.
I'd earned those beers and got a good night's sleep because the next morning, I'd be crossing the guts of Texas.
It's 6:30 in the morning. I'm leaving early because I've got a lot of road to... Where the hell is my car? My car's not small, but it's absolutely dwarfed by these American giants. There it is. Still there. Okay. So, let's go. I've got most of Texas to cover today. It's going to be a long, smelly, exhausting, unreliable day, and I just want to go home.
At this point, I have to be honest. The thrill of the journey was fading, and I wanted to get home.
Jeez, the alternator light's already on. It's going to be a long day.
We've got about 400 miles to cover today. It's going to be a long day. The Texas sun is already high in the sky. There are three main problems with the car. The alternator, for example, keeps turning on and off. I think that's caused by a bad earth. I'm not sure. It's behaving itself now. The other problem is that the car won't idle. It dies at idle. And as far as I can tell, thanks to you guys on the internet telling me, it's probably caused by a faulty idle switch in the carburetor. This is a part that needs to be audited, so for the time being I'll just have to continue driving with 2 feet and 3 pedals. And the third problem is the fuel leak, and that seems to be caused by a perished rubber hose connecting the fuel tank to the fuel filler. And the exhaust is on the other side of the car, so it should be okay, but it does mean that there's a smell of fuel, and I'm probably losing about a gallon a day sloshing around and pouring out the back. So as long as those things don't get worse, I can continue.
And as I grabbed some junk food for breakfast, I noticed I was leaving a little trail of petrol everywhere I went.
I'm leaving a puddle of petrol behind me. It's not me, I promise. Someone else. Alright, now. I ordered a menu, like a combo. It comes with a coffee, but I have had really bad experiences with American coffee. I know it's going to make me sound like a coffee snob. We all remember what happened the last time I ordered a coffee. It ended up on the floor. Let's see.
I'd like to say the next few hours were interesting and video worthy, but if you've ever driven across Texas, you'll know just how tiring it is. It's long and tedious. And coupled with the smell of gas, meant that I had to eventually pull over to figure out what the heck was causing me to feel so nauseous.
Yeah, the reason I can smell gas all the time is that it's wet with gas. So, the problem seems to be behind this panel. That's where the filler cap is, down there. Oh, bloody hell. It looks like this thing's come off in the past for some reason. These screws are not original Lada screws. There's the gas tank. But where's the leak? There's bits of crap in the way. This thing's unscrewed.
So obviously this has come out recently, or at least in the last 38 years, and hasn't been screwed back on. This is a protection plate for the gas tank, which is here. So where's the leak coming from? Oh, honestly, I'm exhausted. I think what I might have to do is just see if I can stomach it, and then take the gas tank out when I get home and have a real good look. Bloody hell.
I soldiered on because there was nothing else I could do, and it wasn't long before I'd made it to the city of Houston, Texas, where I got a good night's sleep.
Another day, another leg of the journey. Got my last 3-day transit tag from Washington State, which will allow me to make the journey today out of Houston with my goal. I don't know if I'm going to make it or not because it's going to be about 11 hours of driving, but my goal is the Florida border. Once I get to Florida, I'm going to get a hotel and sleep, and then I'm only about 6 hours from home. It's going to be a long day, but let's do it. I'm getting one last fill up before I get out of Houston. I'm going to need it. This V-Power Nitro Plus. This poor little Russian car has to work hard. Honestly, Houston is a fustercluck. Even at 6:30 in the morning, people here are still doing 30 miles an hour above the speed limit and right up your backside and aggressive lane changing. It's awful. I would be quite happy never to drive in Houston ever again. I thought LA was bad. Houston is terrible. Hurry up, gotta get out of here. Well, she's thirsty today. Here we go, let's go.
There is a crash on your route. Well, of course, have you seen how Houston people drive? No wonder there's a crash holding up my route. Let's go, slowly. Oh yeah, help yourself, it's all right. I've got Soviet brakes. Jesus Christ. Don't stop. So I just went through a toll road and it flashed at me. Google told me to take it. I don't have any money. It did say no cash accepted. So I just went through the flashing light thing. It took a photo of the car from both sides. And now I've just broken the law. Thanks, Google. Bloody hell. So now I've got to call up and figure out what do I do. Because obviously I've got no license plates on the car and I don't want a manhunt after me. I don't like Houston. Houston does not work for me. I want to get out of this hellhole.
If only it was that easy. As I tried to escape, there was yet another major crash on the highways leading out of Houston.
Oh, come on. You can't be serious.
It was very serious, so I took the lead of the other motorists and did a little off-roading, literally. From here I took about 20 miles worth of country side roads to get around the crash. And that's when I noticed the police were after me for not paying that toll.
Not for me, thank God.
Eventually, I got back on the highway, far away from Houston, and before long, I was in the great state of Louisiana.
Welcome to Louisiana. Man, I got out of Texas. I enjoyed Texas as a state, but honestly, it was let down by Houston. That city, what a disaster. The drivers are abysmal, arrogant, and ill-mannered. It's no wonder that they have a major crash every few minutes there. The roading system, the highway system, is like an afterthought. It's terribly signposted, and all the cat's eyes are missing from the highways. Honestly, Texas, what an amazing state, let down by an abysmal city called Houston. Whew.
But my Houston bashing was quickly overshadowed by the small town of Sulphur in Louisiana, in which I pulled over to grab some gas. It was then I noticed the damage done by recent hurricanes.
Getting another fill up here in Louisiana. But the town, you can tell by the McDonald's sign, has been absolutely destroyed by two hurricanes in short succession. Roofs are all gone, including the roof above me. Top of it's missing. It's just been knocked out.
This place has been leveled.
Before I got back on the highway, I had a look around the side streets to see just how hard it had been hit.
solar poles have all been knocked over as well. Wow.
With the climate changing and the increase in frequency of such storms, it was only a matter of time before another one hit. But I pressed on, being overtaken by almost everything, from trucks to motorhomes to houses. But by far the most interesting piece of engineering I'd seen on the entire trip was an 18-mile-long bridge overlooking a national park in Louisiana. It wasn't the most beautiful bridge I'd ever seen, but at 18 miles long, it was by far the most impressive testament to what mankind can achieve if they want to. From here on, it was highways, 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 going from state to state as I left Louisiana and passed through Mississippi and Alabama, even taking a tunnel under the river itself in Mobile, which meant I was only miles away from the Florida border. And with thousands of miles and days of torment under my belt, I was ready to cross the border into the state of Florida.
I'm back in Florida. Oh my God, I've never been so happy to see all those beautiful license plates with the Florida oranges on them. Oh man, it's good. Oh, I'm so happy.
Yes, I was happy, but I was utterly exhausted.
Almost done. Tomorrow.
Another day. Last leg of the journey. Getting out of this motel, which is cheap but not fancy. Let's just say I woke up to the sound of my neighbors having some adult fun. But it was actually reassuring to know that someone else around here is getting screwed, not just me in Houston yesterday. Alright, let's hit the road.
I'm leaving a bit early again, trying to get away at 6 o'clock this morning. Not only because I want to beat the traffic, but also because I really want to get home. Come on, Sputnik. Take me home. With the car behaving itself, it was time to finally head home.
Continue for half a mile.
Oh, see, now you're giving me instructions, but where were you in Houston? This bloody Google cow.
The Florida sun was rising above the trees, which was a welcoming sight after 8 days of travel. And with each passing mile, I was slowly getting happier and happier, more optimistic that yes, I'm actually going to do it. It wasn't until I got past the city of Jacksonville, however, that I realized I was homebound. I was almost there. And the off-ramp to St. Augustine in Florida was a welcoming sight beyond words. It meant that my house was just minutes away, and after days of effort, victory was tantalizingly close.
Oh my God. I've done it. Oh my God. Oh, far out. I did it. 6,000 kilometers. That's 3,700 miles across the United States in an almost 40-year-old Soviet off-roader. Oh man, I've wanted to do this trip since I was a little kid, and I've just done it. And this, of all cars, this ancient thing. Oh, thank you, Sputnik, for getting me home in one piece. You temperamental little Russian bitch.
So there you have it. 6,000 kilometers or 3,700 miles across these incredible United States, meeting all kinds of interesting people from all walks of life, experiencing highs and lows, experiencing the very best and worst of long-distance motoring, seeing all kinds of incredible landscapes, from the mountains and lush forestry of Washington State, to the beautiful oceans of San Diego, to the deserts below sea level of Arizona, the mountains, the rivers, the cactuses, the cars, the incredible people. It's been one hell of an adventure, but now the work begins on converting this car to run on electricity. So I hope you'll join me along the way as I slowly upgrade this vehicle to pure electric power, but doing so in a way that if I want to convert it back to gas to keep its original feeling, I can. So please do stick around, because I hope to see you in the next adventure coming very soon.